Penguin Random House Audio presents Proust's Duchess, How Three Celebrated Women Captured the Imagination of Fin-de-Siecle Paris, by Caroline Weber, read for you by Suzanne Toren. Let my blood flow into your thoughts. Let my veins pour into your dreams, filling them with opals. Your love will be made of my dreams. Elisabeth Grefful, Tua Res Agitur, circa 1887. And so it is that the most beautiful flowers of our dreams have our blood for sap and our minds for roots. Marcel Proust, The Little Shoes by Monsieur Louis Gondrax, 1892. Overture, Like a Swan. Marcel Proust was never a morning person, but for a short while in the spring of 1892, he got out of bed early. The routine was always the same. After quickly dressing, he set out from his family's apartment near the Place de la Madeleine, in one of the luxury residential buildings that had sprouted up along the Parisian boulevards a few decades prior, and headed west into the Faubourg Saint-Honoré, the most prestigious neighborhood on the right bank. In the second half of the 19th century, this was the province of the flâneurs, but Proust, then a 20-year-old law student, was no dandy out for an idle stroll around town. He strode with purpose, in search of elegance, and while he didn't know her yet, for elegance was a woman, he did know where she lived. It was there that he hurried each morning, at some risk to his delicate health. As he would confess to her a quarter of a century later, "I used to have a heart attack every time I saw you." To make this perilous trip, he took a path he had christened My Route of Hope. It began with a sharp right out of the Proust's apartment building, a seven-story limestone wedge that cleaved the surging traffic of the Boulevard Malesherbes like a ship's prow slicing through choppy waters. This turn brought him straight away into the funereal hush of the Rue de la Ville-l'Évêque, a short side street that led past a row of single-family mansions, or hôtels particuliers, as big as ocean liners and still as tombs. Approaching the Ministry of the Interior, Proust veered left down the block-long Rue des Saussées and into the Place Beauvau, where he paused just long enough to take in the titles on display in the windows of the Émile Paul bookstore. Then he made another right turn into quiet. 5 more minutes of brisk walking led him to his destination, a narrow 4-story residential building at 34 Rue de Miroménil. With its cheap stucco facade and its sooty dormered roof, this structure had nothing visibly special about it. Built a century earlier, it lacked the modern amenities Proust and his family enjoyed at home: an elevator, efficient ventilation, bathrooms with running water. But to him, the shabby sliver of a building was the promised land. Holy, because inhabited by the goddess whose exit he now, stationed on the sidewalk across from the front door, anxiously awaited. Most mornings he didn't have to linger for long before she stepped outside. A petite blonde countess in her early 30s, she would give no indication that she had spotted the dark-eyed, dark-haired youth gawking at her from across the street. Though the Rue de Miroménil being neither busy nor wide, he would have been hard to miss. As she made her habitual left turn toward the Place Beauvau, Proust afforded her a brief head start before taking off at a trot behind her. Luckily for him, she tended on these jaunts to eschew the company of a liveried footman, an indispensable chaperone for most women of her class, and a deterrent to precisely the sort of behavior in which Proust was engaging. Dogging his lady's brisk athletic steps around the quarter, she had a trim figure and liked to keep it that way, he loitered outside the imposing hôtels where she stopped to leave her calling cards, outside the boutiques where she did her shopping, and outside a ducal palace off the Place de la Concorde, where she paid 2 visits a day, the first and last stops on her busy social round. He jogged up and down her favorite promenade, the Champs-Élysées, in her wake, dodging carriages and pedestrians so as not to lose the trail. From a discreet distance, he strained for glimpses of her aquiline profile and her bright blue eyes, the color of the sky of France, also the color of the cornflowers on her hat. Committing every last detail of her face and dress to memory, he marveled at the alchemy whereby she turned a simple morning walk into a whole poem of elegance, the finest adornment, the rarest flower under the sun. Quite obviously, a creature this transfixing couldn't be just anyone, and indeed she was not. The object of Proust's obsession was a celebrity mondaine, society woman, a friend to royals, a muse to artists, a cynosure of the nobility, the darling of the social columns, a fantasy to strangers, and the quintessence, he wrote, of the singular, elevating glory, otherwise found solely in white peacocks, black swans, queens in captivity. But these qualities also made her maddeningly inaccessible to her young admirer, for while he and his mondaine lived in the same part of town, their social milieus, hers the haute noblesse, his the haute bourgeoisie, lay worlds apart. Still, Proust nurtured the hope that one day she would take him under her wing and bear him aloft to a realm of pure, ineffable glamour. And so he trailed along behind her each morning, a stray puppy imprinting on a swan. As the biographer George Painter points out, this was an absurd form of wooing, a conclusion Proust himself would only reach in middle age, when he waxed rueful about his boyish efforts to catch a bird of paradise beneath the trees of the Avenue Gabriel. But at the time, the futility of the hunt was a lesson he would have to learn the hard way. One spring morning, several weeks into his stalking campaign, the Countess stunned him by whirling about to face him and issuing a sharp rebuke. "Fijan is waiting for me!" The first words she had ever addressed to Proust, they demoralized him for 2 reasons. Comte Robert de Fijam was everything Proust was not, a dashing former naval officer and Bourbon courtier, whose family and friends filled the pages of the Almanach de Gotha, a social register for royalty and the high nobility. The head of the Comte's family, the Duke of Alba, Berwick, and Fitzjames, was said to be the most titled man in Europe, more heraldically laden than even the Queen of England. An accomplished horseman and shot, Fitzjames, whose surname only bluebloods knew to pronounce Fijam, was a pillar of Paris's sportiest, most selective men's club, the Jockey, famously closed to commoners and Jews. As rivals for his damsel's favor went, the young man could not have conceived of a more daunting opponent than Comte Robert de Fijam. Even more discouragingly, the voice of Proust's divinity did not fit with the sublime image he had formed of her. When she finally spoke to him, he should have heard the music of the spheres. Instead, he heard the squawk of a hoarse, cantankerous parrot. So much for his rara avis. "Perhaps the most real thing about her beauty lay in my desire," he reflected in an essay he wrote the following year. "She has lived her life, but I alone, perhaps, have dreamed her." This conclusion was only partially correct. Yes, Proust had dreamed his rare bird into being, but by the time he came along, countless others had dreamed her too, reimagining her as a poem and a queen, an exquisite flower and a mythic swan. More than he knew, perhaps, their dreams suffused and shaped his own. So did the dreams of the lady herself. She had lived her life, but in 2 registers, fact and fiction, And like those countless others who had dreamed her too, she strongly favored fiction. Not just in their dreams, but in her own. She had seen herself reborn as a poem and a queen, an exquisite flower and a mythic swan. Not just in their eyes, but in her own, she had become, in fact, a fiction. And she had undergone this change.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.